Steady As She Goes, a Jesse McDermitt novel, Caribbean Adventures Series, Book 21. Written by Wayne Stinnett. Narrated by Nick Sullivan. Dedication. To the memory of Colonel Roy Shelton, who served our great nation from 1963 to 1993 as a Marine Corps officer. Colonel Shelton passed away suddenly on March 18, 2021, at the age of 79. It was also the day I began writing this novel. He and I rode many missions together with upstate South Carolina Patriot Guard riders, honoring those service members and first responders who'd fallen before us. He was an easy man to talk to, always making other riders laugh with his sharp wit and sea stories. He always had a ready smile and words of advice or encouragement. He also was a quiet and kind man, and I'm certain he never told an untruth in his life. The Colonel was a big reason I started writing. In June of 2013, after a ride briefing, he and I were talking. The PGR is a hodgepodge mixture of civilian and veteran bikers. He and I were often the only two Marines in the group, and Marines tend to gravitate toward one another. On that particular day, while talking about books we'd read, Roy told me I should write a novel. He was a colonel, I was a corporal. The oaths we each swore decades earlier had no expiration date. Part of the oath I swore said, "I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me." So I told him, "Aye, aye, sir," and started writing my first novel the next day. The colonel never ordered me to stop. Thanks for the kick in the pants, sir. Semper Fi, brother. The highest form of evidence in English common law is the sworn word of a person of good repute. This tenet is also the basis of our legal system. In other words, just as one is considered innocent until proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, one is considered to be telling the truth unless it can be proven otherwise beyond a reasonable doubt. Colonel Roy H. Shelton, USMC, retired. Chapter 1. August 6th, 2021. Osmond Mejia stood in the open doorway of his home. Behind him, on the other side of the dirt road, the Essequibo River flowed lazily past, oblivious to all but its steady march to the sea. He and his oldest son had just returned from a night of fishing, having caught several hundred kilograms of shrimp, one of their best nights in months. They'd met with a ship at dawn to deliver their catch. They did this to avoid the heavy taxes that were levied if the catch were brought to shore and sold at the docks in Parica or nearby Georgetown. His house wasn't much, just three rooms and a roof, but Osmond had built it himself on land that had been left to him by his father, land that would one day belong to his sons. The door to the small house was hanging on one hinge. The room inside was in complete disarray. What little furniture there was had been overturned or pushed around in an obvious struggle. His wife, two daughters, and youngest son weren't there to greet him.
"This is bad, bad," muttered Augusto behind him.
In Guiana Creole, or Guyanese, as the locals would call it, there is no word for very, and adjectives and adverbs are often repeated for emphasis. Guyana was a poor, poor country, made infamous in 1978 by Jim Jones and his cult, the People's Temple Agricultural Project, when they all committed mass suicide by drinking poisoned Kool-Aid. Osmond dropped to his knees in the doorway and began to sob. His son pushed past him, looking around. He picked up a toy that belonged to his little brother, a handmade stuffed sheep, which little Franco slept with every night. There was sound outside, and Augusto turned, dropping the toy to the bare wood floor. A neighbor stood beyond the porch, the dark river behind him. He looked at the father and son with deep, sorrow-filled eyes. His name was David Clark, and he walked with the aid of a crude crutch.
As a boy, he'd had his left leg mangled by a huge black caiman while netting fish in the Essequibo. Osmond turned and saw David, who cast his eyes down at the ground beneath his feet.
"Raiders came to the village," was all the crippled man could say.
Augusto helped his father to his feet, and they stepped down off the porch together.
"Raiders?" Augusto asked the man. "They came in the middle of the night," David said. "They took my Mariam."
Fire flashed in young Augusto's eyes. Mariam was a year younger than him, the same age as the oldest of his two sisters.
"Who were they?"
Osman asked, his voice cracking.
"From across the border," David replied. "They came by boat."
Augusto took a step toward the man who was supposed to be his father-in-law one day.
"How do you know they were Venezuelan?" "They knocked me down, Augusto, as if I were just a nuisance to them. They spoke the Spanish."
"How long ago?"
David shook his head.
"Late last night. They took a dozen others, including your brothers, sisters, and mother. They are long gone, and the authorities have yet to arrive."
"We must go after them," Augusto implored his father.
"Our boat is the fastest on the Essequibo." "Their boat is much faster," David said. "A big open boat, with three motors on the back."
Augusto looked over at David.
"Did nobody try to stop them?"
"Andres tried," David said. "The raiders had guns. Andres is dead."
"We must gather the people," Augusto declared. "Did anyone see or hear anything else?"
Though young, only 17, Augusto was a natural leader. All his peers looked up to him, and his father was on the village council, so that gave the young Guyanese some say in the overall community. The older men admired his calm confidence and inner strength. And he'd been abroad, working as a deckhand on a cargo ship for all of his 16th year. He'd traveled and seen much of the coast of South America and even up to the northern islands of the Caribbean, Puerto Rico, St. Croix, and St. Thomas, islands owned by the United States. The crippled man nodded.
"They were from Caracas. This was overheard as they took our people away."
Augusto thought for a moment. Caracas was a long way, almost a week in his father's boat. A fast boat like David had described couldn't possibly make the journey without many stops for petrol, and that was a rare commodity on the desolate coast. Plus, carrying a dozen captives in an open boat would draw suspicion wherever they stopped. Augusto turned to his father.
"The boat took them to a ship offshore."
Osman looked up at his son.
"But which one?" "Only last night we saw four ships go by as we worked the nets. There must be many more out there every day."
"I must get to a telephone," Augusto said, already planning what to do and say.
"You know there are none in the village, my son. And who would you call?"
"When I was in Puerto Rico," Augusto began, "I met an American. He used to be a soldier, but he lost a leg."
Osman looked back at their home.
"What good is a one-legged cripple?"
"He told me that he worked for a man who fixes things when the government cannot."
"What man is this?"
David asked, stepping closer.
"He said he worked for a man named Jack Armstrong."
Chapter 2. Monday, August 16th, 2021. Over the past few months, I'd gotten a feel for her, a deep connection and greater understanding of how she behaved in all kinds of situations. When you're together 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, it'd be surprising not to. But the relationship was constantly changing, evolving, as we got to know one another more intimately. During the first few weeks we were together, I studied every detail of her, how she moved and reacted, the sounds she made, the subtle nuances she would divulge to me alone. Niles Hansen had explained what I should expect from her and what her limitations were. And more importantly, he showed me what she would demand from me at all times.
"She can be very insistent at times," he'd told me, "and you will become the only man she will completely trust and rely on."
It was a complicated relationship, exacerbated by the fact that I could never completely understand everything about her. She would always keep something.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.